Yeah, hi. First up, super excited for this conversation. Like I said earlier that, I was really hoping to connect with an educator who's achieved so much, a woman who's, had a fantastic 2020. You've had your second baby in it. And of course, Byju's has achieved so much success in the last 1 year. So congratulations on a fabulous year that it has been.
Thank you, Mansi. I think it's been challenging and fabulous, and I think we were very fortunate to be in a segment of positive relevance. Education is one segment which really could create an impact in unfortunate times like these, and we saw that happen because we were literally able to help students continue learning, and they did not miss out on something that is so crucial for their development.
Right, Divya, tell me a little bit about you as a child and your childhood, because I truly believe that who you are today is a product of your childhood, right? Like there are these little seeds that are sown into the person that you are today.
True. No, very, very rightly said. And, typically, and for women, especially when you come out and then you speak, and then a lot of times questions which are typically asked is, what are the challenges faced? What are the obstacles you faced? And I say, you know what? Look at me as an example of what would happen if you give equal opportunity to a girl. Because literally till the time I entered the workplace, I never even knew of gender bias. It was like I was not only the only daughter, I'm the only child of my parents. So I was brought up, my entire world was about equality. It was about how you give equal opportunities, whether it's a boy or a girl. Never once faced discrimination because of my gender. And right throughout, I started swimming at the age of 5. I was into gymnastics. I sang. Everything would go to the British Library on the weekends with my mother. Both working parents. So, and I think that's something, because when you grow up as an only child and with working parents, if your mother is not giving you a lot of time, you really feel very isolated. That never happened to me. Although I did crib at times for a sibling. I feel, and I never feel that I missed out on having company. And another thing was that I come from a defense background. My father's from the Air Force. So I had a lot of friends. We lived in this apartment complex in Bangalore where we had a lot of people to play with and grow with. And that's so important. Social skills are developed when you spend time outdoors with people. And one thing was that although I was fortunate to not be relocated so many times, my friends would literally change every 2 years. So exposed to diversity in the country, diverse people, diverse thoughts, diverse cultures, diverse ideas. So I think that is something that has shaped me into who I am today. So that, and along the way, I think I was somebody who was very academically oriented, but also very focused on sports, because my parents always instilled in me the importance of an all-round development. And it was not that I was always into my books or anything. So it was just that I enjoyed learning, but I enjoyed playing as well. I still remember my grandfather taking me and making me run rounds around the, the football tracks. So I still actually remember that. And along with my parents, it was my grandparents as well, because as I mentioned, my parents were working. So childhood was all about this. And then I went and did my 11th and 12th, very competitive, because the two most crucial years of your life. So I gave it, and maybe those 2 years were the years where I kind of focused on my studies, came out, did really well, almost became a doctor. My father's a doctor actually. So almost became a doctor. I don't know, for some reason, even though I went for my counseling and I got into the best colleges in Bangalore for medicine, we just didn't take it at that point of time. My father thought, let her do engineering, keep her options open. So I did an engineering in biotechnology, because biology was one of my favorite subjects and I loved math. A rare combination, bio and math together. Not many people like both. So I did my undergrad in biotechnology in RB College in Bangalore. And at the end of 4 years, I was actually a university rank holder as well, and from VTU. At that point of time, I was supposed to go abroad because, biotech was in its nascent stages in 2007. It wasn't the way it is today. There weren't so many opportunities. My aunt was a biotechnologist abroad. And at that point is when I met Byju. I attended his classes. And there was this period between, you apply for an admission and you get a seat. So those were the 3-4 months where he said, hey, why don't you just take a class? And I went for a class. And I still remember it was a gallery seating 100 students from a very simple diploma engineering college, people getting in, attending this class so that they can learn personality skills, they can learn to crack that tough interview to get in to a job and support their families. Very simple background. And the impact it created, I could see the satisfaction. And, you know, class after class, I felt that this is something which I can do for a longer period of time, something where I can see an impact happening, something where, because education is something where you get a lot of satisfaction as a teacher. So I started out as a teacher, never knew what the journey had for me, never knew that, you know, this is how we would do what we are doing today, but always fixated on a mission that we are in education. Content is the king, and that's the focus of all that we do, make children love learning. So here we are today, and I think it's been, I mean, very unpredictable, but great in terms, but like I said, a long way to go. We've just started. You know, it's an expanse. So,
right. So Divya, you mentioned that you were also into gymnastics, swimming, you love singing. Did your parents, were you the topper of your class? Was there a lot of emphasis on, you know, like how parents are sometimes very unidimensional? Okay, you know, you're singing, dancing, or you're sab to theek hai, but grades are grades, and that's a non-negotiable. Was that a non-negotiable in your house?
No, I wouldn't say that. My father was more academically focused. My mother was more into all-round development. So it was a balance, thank God for that. I mean, if both of them are the same, then I would say there was immense pressure. But I think, my father is also very academically focused. And, you know, to be a doctor, it's not easy. And he has so many degrees, like quite a bit of them. So considering the fact that he let me go after an engineering itself, it's something great. So for them, for him especially, I think academics was very, very important. But I wouldn't say that he discouraged me from any of the extracurricular activities. So my mother was played a bigger role when I was growing up, because if you are a doctor, you have to give your 100% to the job. I mean, it's only then you can do it in the best possible way. So I practically don't even remember him getting involved in my growing up years. It's been my mother through and through. It's been her parents through and through, who were, in it, who helped me, molded me into the kind of person that I was. My father has been a very silent role model. I've always looked up to him. He's been my first teacher, I would say. All the science topics and everything he used to teach me, so I've learned it from him. I've developed my penchant for biology from him, I can say that. He also says that, you know, I speak nicely because of him. I say, okay, it's possible. So he speaks really well as well. So he jokes around today and says that. So I think, you know, these kind of things, they all, and if I say, you know, it's not one person. A lot of people say, who's your mentor? Whom did you look up to? It's definitely my mother. Although it's something that I've come to realize now, I've taken it for granted that I would have a professional career, because I've seen her work. I've seen her manage a family. I've seen her manage office and do it both so well.
Yeah, I have to ask you two questions here. One, I really appreciate you saying that my father was my silent mentor, right? Because I feel in every household, there is one primary parent, can be the mother or father. And there is this second parent who's, you know, like, who's omnipresent, but he's very, very important. He or she is very important. So I'm glad that you mentioned that. I know you mentioned that when you were, you know, going to go abroad for your biotechnology, you know, you decided to stay back and not take that, not pursue that. And I want you to share with me two things. One is, what was your parents' reaction when you said, this is what I wanted to do, but I don't want to do it now because my perspective has changed? What was their reaction? And what would you tell to parents today when they say, you know, when the kids actually are struggling to pursue something which their parents want, but they actually want to do something else? What would you tell their parents?
Yes. So two things. One is, and this is something that I've always lived by. Before you take a decision, it's very important to do enough research on it. Think deeply about it. Look at the pros, look at the cons, think ahead, deliberate, ask people around you. Listen, and because people have so many perspectives, it's important to listen, but it's important to ultimately listen to yourself. But once you take the decision, and I've always followed this, never ever look back and never ever deliberate whether that was the correct decision that you took, because you've taken it. Now nothing is undoing that. So that's one thing which has really helped, and it's helped us along the way, even in our journey as Byju's, as we've grown as a company, where we've taken radical decisions to completely change the way we operate. We've disrupted ourselves positively. And you never look back, because once you've taken a decision, it's important that you stick by it. Only then can you make it successful. And this is not when I was 14, 15. This is when I was 21. So when you're 21, you kind of know what you want. I would not say everybody would know what they want, but I was very, very sure. And I had reasons A, B, C, D, E, why I want to stay back. And of course, with a dollop of, I'll say intuition, that I knew that this is going to work. So that's how it was. And I know a lot of parents look at degrees as a safety net. And I would say it's a good to have, especially if I was faced with an option where without that safety net, I could have done something for myself. So it's a different case. But there are situations where you need to have that safety net so that you have more options available to you when you go into the wider world. So I would not disagree with parents like that who want the best for their children. And I would say, especially for girls, you're so lucky that your parents are investing in educating you. You're on the other side. You're on the positive side. You're on the lucky side. And I would say take it, because there are so many people where this opportunity is not even available, where, you know, they're treated differently. Unfortunately, that is the actual situation. Like I said, I'm extremely lucky. And not many people are like me. At least I would say half the people are not like me. If you look at the numbers, right, 53, more than half are graduates are women, but only 23% of them are in the workforce. That shows a lot about the disparity. So I would say take it. If you're given an opportunity to educate yourself, if parents are willing to invest in you, please take it, because you're getting an opportunity to do something which a lot of women are not allowed to do. But that being said, if it's something where there is a clash, like, you know, the child wants to pursue something, the parent is not, and a parent doesn't want them to do it, or vice versa, I would say it's always better to go with the child, because you know where your interests are. Like someone who's a born artist, trying to make them pursue a core science subject, it's not going to do good for anybody, right? So maybe I can also give you an example of what we did in Byju's when we started our media team. So if you look at our product, it's very visually deep. It's created, but it's not created by ordinary animators. It's actually created by technologists who have a passion for art. So if you look at it, you can find your passion. And in today's world, which is very visual, it's possible to mix art and science. So my message to people who are trying to find their niche, who are really good in art, but, you know, are also good in math and science, is that if that comes together, it's a deadly combination. We've seen that happen here. Because when I, as a teacher, I'm trying to explain to someone behind the scenes that, you know, this is how you need to bring the DNA to life. If someone knows it, they can visually bring it out so much better. So I would say it's always an advantage.
Right. Tell me, when you co-founded the company, did you think it would change the education landscape in the country?
So if you ask me, I wanted to take it one child at a time. And would it change the life of a student who's learning? For everyone it touches, yes. Because this is the best way to learn, and we know it. And we believe in it so strongly, because our children also learn this way outside school. And I stress on outside school. It's very important, because what school gives you is social skills. It teaches you important life skills like empathy, which can never be replicated in 100% online model. So yes, you know, as we would say, we took it one product at a time. We took it one step at a time. What was the first thing we wanted to do? We wanted to make something which is not for the motivated few. Because if you look at all the resources which are available online, free or otherwise, it targets, you already need to be motivated to learn from something which is not visually appealing. So the first step was to create content in a way that would appeal to majority of the people. And we know that that's something which we managed to crack, because within 2 months of the launch of the app, we had 2.5 million downloads. So that will happen only if students are liking the format in which you're presenting it to them, because they're a very choosy audience, if you ask me, you know. And as they get younger, they become more digitally aware. So you need to give them something which is unique, something which is different. It's almost like, you know, chocolate covered broccoli. That's what we do. The core concepts are hidden behind layers of fun and engagement. So they end up learning the concepts. So, and like you said, today we are almost 90 million. Right. We have 90 million free students on our platform. So we never envisioned that it would be here. But like I said, there is so much more. And it's also because India is a country where there is so much focus on learning. I think it's the right place to start. And as we aspire to go global, as we aspire to go deeper into India, I think one of the best decisions is to start in a country like India, where there is so much importance given to education, because this is the only way to make it big for most of us.
Right.
Divya, I wanted to ask you here today that, you know, today you are a working parent as well. There is just so much that a parent needs to do today. That they're almost overwhelmed. Like, I don't want one more online resource tool for my child because I'm barely managing to stay afloat with online school, even for a 3-year-old or a 5-year-old or a 6-year-old, that I don't want to invest in one more online tool. What would you say to them would be the differentiator, and how are you managing it?
Yeah, actually, if you ask me, for working mothers, especially if we manage through the last 1 year, I think we'll sail through the next decade. it's not been easy because, you know, you're managing work, you're managing home. This work from home is, like I said, I've never done it, but it's tougher than what I thought it would be. From the time my eldest son was born in 2013, we had a 3-month back then, yeah, in terms of a maternity break. That was the last that I stayed at home. And took a break. I would say that time I took a break. This time it was like,
you didn't jump the 3 months. You didn't say, okay, 3 months is too much, I need to get back to work earlier.
That time, no. I was recording my classes for the app during the break. So whenever my son was sleeping, I would record all the videos. At that time, the focus was on creating the product. So, you know, I don't take it as work. For me, it's like, you know, I loved it. I love teaching. Yeah. So I guess I did start working from, you know, the like maybe a week after the first one was born. But at that moment, the number of people were lesser, and it was more like you individually create an impact. You teach, and then so that happened in the first break. But I didn't go to office, so I'm coming from there. But in the last 1 year, staying at home, that's been, it's not been easy because there are two, like at least for the last 5 months, there have been two. And managing school, and it's not just, I can totally resonate with every working mother, but a few things which I've done and which kind of have given me some sort of peace of mind. And one is that creating artificial boundaries around myself, because when you go to office, you can literally, you know, close yourself away from home and focus on what you're doing and then come back. And then, you know, you be with your kids full time or you be with your family full time. But, you know, the other way around, where you have to create an artificial boundary where anybody can storm into the room for anything. It's not easy to handle that. So that creating, and that's something which over the last 1 year, I've kind of tried to do it. I think I've been able to do it. So that being said, I think you asked me about, you know, parents being overwhelmed. I do agree because, you know, and we are so much an integral part of the learning journey today. This has never happened before. I think the respect for teachers has really gone up, which is a great thing. Right. And
absolutely.
So
I think it's a tough one.
It's not an easy job at all, right? Keeping so many students engaged and making sure that everybody's learning. So if you ask me about screen time specifically, I would say that every generation has faced some sort of a challenge. Like I think when I grew up, it was about how much TV is enough. You know, it was about how much video games are enough. So the generation between me and my son, how many video games can you play? Because now because of digital and technology, the generations have become shorter. I think there are 3 generations between me and my son in a way. So, you know, in terms of, so it's about, I think, how much and what kind of screen time, because look, you know, you can't stay away from it. It's going to happen, but can you moderate it? Can you make sure that the right kind of content is what they're consuming? Otherwise, some of the apps, it just goes somewhere from one to another to another. And that is where I think if parents can, you know, it's almost like, you know, how much and what is what parents is what parents decide. And children decide, like, you know, how do they want to consume it? Maybe, you know, if it could be a dual decision rather than a parent saying that, you know, like only 15 minutes. Is what you get. Maybe trading off and saying that, you know, 30 minutes you learn something, and why don't you play a game for 15 minutes? Because that's also important. Even video games teach you stuff. It's not that it doesn't. Right. So I think maintaining a healthy balance.
Absolutely. I think it is so important. And I keep telling this to parents on the platform as well, that, you know, I think we're raising children in who are born into technology. So trying to resist that from them is definitely not going to work. And this active and passive engagement while they're on digital, right? So if they're learning through it, then of course it's great. But if it's a passive babysitter, then of course it's not a good thing. And another thing I must mention is, you know, when I interviewed Andre Agassi, and he said rules without relationships will always equal to rebellion, right? So for every parent who's resisting that screen time, if you've not built that ground up on explaining your child, like Divya said, then it's never going to...
Totally agree. One rule which I had while growing up, I've never said no to my elder son. I've never used the word no with him, and that I consciously stayed away from because I've seen children use it back.
Yeah.
So I've always looked at, like, if even if they were doing something,
that I need to know, how did you manage that?
By explaining why.
Yeah.
You know, because beyond three, they're able to understand. Until three, it's fine. Now it's beyond that where it becomes. So by saying no, you're just making them rebellious. No without a reason doesn't do good for anyone. It's always, and I think that worked because I've never heard him say no. And I've never heard him, like, I won't say that I'm a good parent. Good parents for me and Baiju are our parents who managed to, you know, bring us up. And I think we are here today because of them. But if we can do some justice, we've done it in our own way by giving them all the love and making sure that, you know, it's very, very difficult to create a balance between strict and because see, all relationships and everything falls in place with respect for me more than fear. So I would rather lead by examples. If you don't want your child to look too much at the screen and waste time, you want them to read books yourself. Because they learn so much from not what you tell them, but from what they see that you do.
Absolutely. Tell me, Divya, with teaching hundreds and thousands of students to teaching your own kids, how difficult is it? And do you manage to grab the time to teach him?
So he learns from, so it's school for him. And apart from school, most of his learning comes because now he's in grade one. He goes through the app. And he learns his concepts from the app. But see, learning is a very open world. And I would say to make a child whom they are today, there is so many things which influence, their learning. Because math is in everyday life. It's all around us. So he loves to play games. So whenever he plays cricket, I'll say there's a lot of correlation between math and cricket. So he's learned addition completely by adding the runs he has scored, you know, in his mind. So there is six and then there is another six and then there is another four and there is another 10. And so this, you relating it to real life examples is how, and I think it's just about giving that impetus after the children start learning on their own. Then they start looking at math, and I'm just taking math because it's considered one of the most important subjects to learn when, you know, for us, for now and for the future as well. Most of our jobs rely on math. So that I think, you know, in teaching them how to integrate it into real life. For example, when he's a big Disney Cars fan. So when he was 2.5, so he learned numbers by looking on the car. So Doc Hudson is 51, McQueen is 95, for example. So these are ways which they picked up and showing them. So there are a lot of ways you can make learning fun. So it's not that, you know, you sit across with a book and teach. That's never the way learning happens. Learning happens in little things that you do. It can happen when you eat. It can happen when you play. So,
right. You know, you mentioned about math, and I had seen your earlier interviews where you mentioned math is something that you need for everyday living. Tell me, would you be disheartened if he was that kid, like a lot of children who grow up hating math or fearing math, I would say. Would you be disheartened? And what would you tell to parents whose kids really, really fear math?
So it's about... if you look at it, nobody's born hating math. So it's about can you take them onto a subject which is so crucial and lead them onto it by instilling a love for it, which is totally possible. Most of the children don't like math, or most of the children who don't like math because I think they feel it's too abstract, which it's not. So there is squares and square roots and all of that happening. And if you can't relate to it, if you don't see it around you, then it becomes very abstract. You can't relate. Like, how many people relate that addition and multiplication is actually the same thing? Addition many times is multiplication, but we relate separately. We learn it in different grades. We learn it in different, you know, in different chapters, but it's actually the same thing. So teaching them, so the otherwise that becomes one concept. Addition is concept one, subtraction is concept two, multiplication is concept three, division is concept four, or addition and multiplication is just one concept. You add many times, you multiply. So I think it's about making it, it is very, very simple. But can you teach a child that it's simple? Can you instill the love for them as they grow up? So to all parents, there is a huge way in which we can address this, because parents are a child's first teacher. So this is not rocket science math. This is basic math. If you can just show them that it's all around them, and I'm speaking about this since you told me that, you know, a lot of parents have this, oh my God, my child doesn't like math. If we as parents can pick up simple things and link it to what a child loves and show them that, look, math is all around you. Count the spoons, put it on the table. Four. Great. Now, what if you make them into two equal parts? Push two this side, push two that side. I mean, these are all just simple things. I'm just coming up with it right now. But these things, if parents can do, children start relating to math around them. It doesn't become a chore. Like, it usually right. does.
Yeah, absolutely. Like someone said, there are no bad students. There are just bad teachers. So I think we need to change the way we reorient ourselves. Tell me, Divya, you make things sound so simple. And you're juggling so many different things. What's your superpower that people don't see on social media that still works in the background and makes everything else happen?
There is no superpower. It's like I also face my, I also get, you know, overwhelmed at times. It's not that, you know, like what you see here is not indicative of, but it's about acceptance, I think, you know, for every woman. Accept that there are so many things happening in life. Accept that family is important, work is important, one at a time. I think because this whole multitasking feature, which we talk about so much, you know, women are multitaskers, that same thing can come back and hit you. Because if you try to do 10 things all at one time, you end up giving 10% to each rather than, you know, picking up one by one and then giving 100% to maybe the top five. You can't do 10. It's okay. Accept it. Pick up the top five and give it, you know, 100% attention one at a time. And that's something which I do. When I do something, I do it completely. I try not to distract myself, although I know that there may be 6-7 pressing things, but you just do it one at a time. You're quicker at it and you end up resolving it completely. And you also tick it off. Plus I am a planner, and I think nothing happens without planning. So while as a company, we have big dreams, we have big aspirations, but we also have broken down our goals into quarterly goals, monthly goals, weekly goals, and I would also have daily goals, because that sort of planning helps you give more time to each thing, give it the appropriate amount of time, and also make sure that you do it in the best possible way. The entire founding team, the top management, has been consistent over the years, and that's because we are great listeners. We are also people who lead by example. So all of us are very hands-on. We don't just tell people what to do. We show them how it needs to be done. And I don't speak for myself. I speak for everybody in the team. So when I say being present and being approachable, what I mean to say is, if there is any concern, anybody in the organization knows that they can reach out to us. And that, to maintain that at scale, is something which is very critical, because we should not lose that founder mentality as we become a bigger organization. We should not lose the fungibility of a startup. We should not lose the camaraderie which is there in a startup, because as you become a big organization, it should not become a process. Putting people above everything else, putting values about everything else is the most important thing, because processes will anyway fall in place.
Right. I also want to ask you this: with the abundance of having so much, how do you teach the values of things to your children?
Yes. So I think it's very valid, because beyond a point, it doesn't matter, right? Like even if you talk about wealth, you talk about fame, so it matters up to a point, but beyond that, it really doesn't matter. And I think if you can tell your children or teach your children that what really matters is family, and you show that, like I said, it's always about leading by example. What makes me happy today is the same thing that makes me happy 10 years back. And I'll give you an example, because for me, the most important thing was being with my parents. And the one of the reasons why I did not go abroad, although it was very subconscious, was I'm the only child. And if I leave them and go, they would be alone. So that was a very subconscious thing playing with me. It's been important to me then. And today also, I fought tooth and nail, and I brought them to the house opposite mine. So these things don't change. Like you the friends you have, the friends who were there with you when you were zero, and you come down and you come up to one, the friends remain the same. And ultimately, I think being with the people who have seen you grow, being with the people who have who understand what matters to you at that point of time, and having that same sort of grounded effect throughout. And it's not just about me. Even Baiju's extremely extremely ground, and we've all come up on our own. We worked really hard. This hasn't happened overnight. It's happened over like decades, for him decades, and I would say at least the last 10 years of investing in how can we make something work. we've done everything possible in a startup to make it grow. It's not just, and we were bootstrapped for the initial 4-5 years. We've put in our money, our effort, our time, and built up the company. So it's a company which is built by us, built with a lot of love. The people have been put you know, by us, and we would, and like I said, right, for us people, and I think that's what we need to teach our kids also. It's not about, you know, who maybe, you know, it's not about which car you're going in. It's about whom you're going with in that car. You know, these are all simple things, and that is, I think, something which parents can definitely inculcate by leading by example.
Right. That's so beautifully said. Who you're going with in the car that matters. Tell me, what's a typical day in the Baiju's Gokulnath household? Like, how is it? Like, what does it begin with? What does it end with?
It definitely begins with work and ends with work. And there is no timetable now because babies have their own agenda. You know, so it's, I'm lucky that I'm at least around now. If he needs me or he cries, I'm there. At least, you know, I can go and be there. But one thing which I immediately got back to doing after delivery was working out. So I've resumed my workouts because I'm like, for me, I think physical health is directly proportional to mental health and well-being. And that is one thing. And it's chaotic. It's planned yet chaotic because there are so many things which come in which need immediate attention, but there are so many things which you would have planned to do which you need to do. And I think it's all about, it's a lot of happiness. It's a lot of, because we are all surrounded by the people whom we love a lot. So there's a lot of love, there's a lot of happiness, there's a lot of joy. I'm very happy because I'm getting my kids with me, because although it's difficult, yet the positive in it is that I would have never gotten these times with them otherwise. And childhood just passes by. Like, the elder one's already 7, and I don't know how that happened.
The younger one will grow up faster, and I keep telling my younger one, listen, can you stop growing up, right? Because I'm not going to have a third one now. So I'm like, you just want to hold on to that piece, right? Divya, I must ask you this. In the last decade, you know, and you just mentioned this, in the last decade of building Baiju's, do you feel like there's something that got left behind that you would want to pick up at a later date? And I know you said you're a woman of no regrets and you don't want to look back, but do you feel like, you know, there were things that could let, things or relationship or people or personal, anything that got left behind that you feel like you want to pick up now?
So frankly, we've taken every day at a time. And I don't know how we could have done on the work front. Maybe we could have done things better. Like, you know, every growing startup, which is growing so fast, has its share of mistakes in this whole spurt of growing. But it's not that we haven't learned along the way. So it's important to keep learning as we have, because only then can you, and always self, and we've reflected. I won't say that we reflect on what we do and then we take the decisions. So no regrets, like you rightly said. But if I have to think of it differently, maybe. So one thing we did is we started with higher grades and then we went to lower grades. Maybe we should have done it the other way around, because if you look at it, they're more digital natives as you grow younger. Like, it would have been, I think the adoption is already very good, but it could have been even more if we started with younger kids and gone up. That being said, of course, we want to do everything very fast, but that's not possible. Like, we launched in vernaculars only last year. So it's gone like much deeper because of that, because we have it now in Hindi and Bengali and Gujarati and so many major regional languages. But could we have done that? If we could have done that 4-5 years back, it would have been even more impact, like as we launched the app. But then things take their time. And we're also coming up with new products to have teachers take classes live for the students. So all of these things, could we have, see, it's just about, can we do it faster, but can we also do it better? But that, see, the thing is, you need to give time for everything to lay out. And there are so many things which circumstances lead you to do. For example, the pandemic. Now, in the first 4.5 years since we launched the app, we had 45 million students on the platform. But in the last 1 year, we have 45 million more. So EdTech, what did not happen in the last few decades, we saw that happen literally in weeks.
Right.
So I think it's about, there is a time for everything. But if you reflect and go back, there could have been decisions which you can take earlier, but no regrets.
Right. Also, you know, like I was mentioning before, that globally, they've said that over 2 billion children have dropped out of, you know, and have, and they say it's the biggest year of loss for education because schools have been shut and kids have been deprived of education. Do you feel, and how do you feel as a founder of an edtech company, and how do you, and plans to plow that back in many ways to, you know, cover up on the loss that that's actually happened in the last 1 year?
The two things, the last 1 year, it's not just been a learning loss. I feel it's also been very critically a playing loss for a lot of children. And both are very important to, in those crucial, especially the younger kids where you just need to go and run and play and you learn so much when you do that. I think that's been a bigger loss because we're literally restricted to homes.
Yeah. And I feel like your life skills, which is like gross motor skills, like climbing, throwing, playing, molding. I feel that generation is actually a bigger loss than anybody else.
Because if you go up the ladder and you go to older kids, you can still learn on your own. You know, you can read and you reach that age. But for very young children, it was literally a loss in development for the last 1 year. Now, that being said, it's also shown us, though, that as a civilization, we can adapt. Because we have adapted overnight to online learning. Now, if you ask me, I don't think it can completely replace offline learning. But a lot of subjects like math and science, we've come to learn that it can be taught and learned better online.
We're still talking of a very, very privileged audience. There has been a huge black hole in terms of reaching the masses, especially in the kind of country that we are in. So any gaps that you feel that you guys can fill in there?
That's right. Overall, globally, it was actually 1.2 billion kids who were out of school. And if you speak about India, and I think that was one impetus for us to launch the whole Byju's Give. So we saw that even though schools transitioned online, especially the poorer families, they couldn't afford to get a device good enough for their child to continue learning. And although what you need is basically a smartphone, but how much time can you use it? And the parent also needs it. So that's when we thought of ways in which we could bridge it. It's a very small step. And the fact is that I want to speak about what we've done only when it becomes big enough that it's created a big impact. That's what I always believe in. But one thing that we did is we launched Byju's Give, you know, because we saw this sort of disparity in children who had access versus those who didn't, where anybody can contribute an old device or donate an old device, and we would load the Byju's course for free and then give, so the learning is completely free for the child. So that's something that we've just started a couple of months back, and we're trying to see whether we can encourage more people to either donate or sponsor, and then we try to reach. But there are so many more companies which can also take this route. Because the fact is, if you think about it, while digital divide is a reality, the disparities which exist in the physical world are much more. Because compare it to the kind of infrastructure a tier one student gets compared to someone in a village. Now, building a school, providing good teachers is far more difficult than providing an internet connection. So maybe in the long run, now this digital divide, I feel, would get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller as we go up. But there are so many things we can do to hasten up the process. I think companies should do all that they can do to bridge it.
Right. With that, I'm going to come straight to a quick rapid fire just to lighten things up, and let's see how you fare. And you need to answer in just a word, okay? So let's see how you do. To people who say women can't have it all,
I would just ask them why not.
Right. Three lessons you learned from your mother.
How to bring up a family, how to have a successful career, and how to make everything look really simple.
Okay. Three lessons you learned from your son.
How to celebrate little things in life. How to unconditionally love everything and everyone around you. How to always be happy.
Right. Entrepreneurial life or motherhood, the tougher journey?
Both very easy.
Okay. Can you pop another baby or raise another startup? Which one would be easier?
Both equally difficult or equally easy.
Okay. One thing you learned from motherhood.
It's important to create artificial boundaries.
Okay. One thing you learned from your entrepreneurial life that helps you in raising your children.
You give it enough love, it'll grow beautifully and love you back.
Okay. One thing you would love to outsource as a mother.
Nothing.
Describe Divya as a mom in a word, and as a teacher and as an entrepreneur. All of it in a word.
Loving.
Okay. Divya as a teacher.
Inspiring.
Okay. And as an entrepreneur?
Empathetic.
Okay. One thing you would do with your child that you absolutely love?
Learn.
Okay. To all the teachers who have seen shut schools through this pandemic?
Stay strong.
Okay. What would you say to moms who say they don't have time to chase their dreams?
Right.
One myth you want to bust as a working mother?
I want to bust a myth which says that men take charge while women take care. Well, I believe that the time has come where women can take care and take charge, and men can take charge and take care.
Amazing. I love that. One struggle when you're trying to balance your life?
Time.
Okay. Apps that you use the most? And Baiju's not included.
Definitely WhatsApp right now.
Okay. Screen time for you is?
Meeting people online.
Okay. I love that. Nobody's answered that. And it's so relevant. The more patient parent between you and Baiju's?
Baiju.
Okay. The better teacher, you or him?
Him. He taught me.
Okay. The better parent, you or him?
Both.
Okay. Who is more likely to forget a PTA meeting, you or him?
Definitely him.
Okay. WhatsApp mommy groups, life savior or I'm not on it?
Passive aggressive.
Okay. I see the diplomatic answer coming in there. What's more important, the will to learn or intelligence?
The will to learn.
Mealtimes for you are like?
Are there mealtimes?
Okay. One life lesson you want to make sure your child imbibes?
Empathy.
One life lesson that has shaped who you are?
Confidence that you are far better than what you think you are.
The title of my book would be?
I haven't really thought about that.
Okay, I want you to think about that and let me know when you do. I'm most curious to know what that answer would be. And of course, last one, the one thing I learned from my husband.
To be positive.
Thank you so much. This has been incredible, and look forward to staying connected.
Thank you so much, Mansi.